Thanks for joining this session. The title of talk I'm gonna. Yeah, it's turned on. Talk about is hard work, which is a lightweight silent data corruption detector for general purpose GPU computing. And here are my collaborators and my advisors, Professor Karvacek and Professor Iyer at CSL. So,
The GPU is
it's surfacing as a platform for general purpose program like science simulation or medical data processing. The reason behind this is the fundamental challenges that designing modern microprocessor, the structural data and control hazard are either eliminated or reduced by the GPU process architecture. So I'm not going to talk about the details, but they are reduced, and the direct exposure of the hardware resources to the programmer allows programmers to heavily optimize their code for the given hardware resources. So those platforms are used for these high-performance general-purpose programs. However, those general-purpose programs has stricter output correctness requirement, which is more stronger than 3D graphics program. While we are playing, for example, games, even there is a fault and one frame or multiple frames are corrupted, users may not care about it. But if we are running science simulation, if one element of the output data is corrupted, for example, more than 1% difference with the as compared with the golden run output, those scientists may care about it. And those quantity are application specific. Sometimes it's 1%, sometimes it's 0.1%, but there is usually certain constraint. And the reason those programs allow this error is they are floating point programs usually. And as we know, no FPU is perfect. They have some inaccuracy or precision errors, so they have to allow some errors. So in this paper, we call those errors in the program output silent error, corruption error, if they violate the program output correctness requirement. So the reason we care about this silent data corruption error is recent data report large percent of hardware permanent or transient fault. For example, here at NCSA in 2009, reported 1.8% of the NVIDIA GPU device has at least one permanent fault in their memory. And similarly, 66% of GPU device has at least one transient fault in the memory. So that was measured in distributed environment. So latest GPUs are often with the CRC or SECDAT ECC. Those are memory protection scheme. But even after this protection, certain types of hardware fault can still occur and propagate to the system without any protection or detection. For example, fault in the ALU or FPU, it's very difficult to protect because those circuits are irregular and their operation speed are very fast, usually every cycle. And the high density chip, the transistor feature size becomes smaller and the particle strike can hit multiple transistors and cause a multi-bit errors. And we need stronger ECC, not the SECDAT ECC. Then the overhead will increase and that become very difficult design challenge for microprocess designers. Also, the wrong execution time of those HPC general purpose program increase the likelihood of experiencing hardware fault. So, this is becoming more significant problem. So we developed a fault injector for those commodity GPU and perform some initial fault injection experiment. And when you have a transient fault in the memory, we have a spike in the ocean surface simulation software, which is quite unnoticeable. But if we had an intermittent fault in the FPU, like even just several milliseconds, that cause these stride patterns in the surface of this simulated ocean, and this is clearly noticeable. So if we have a fault in those computational logics, that might be a big problem. So we perform more comprehensive analysis on it, and our main observation is in GPU programs, when the fault was injected into pointer, integer, or floating point data, some portion of data cause a crash or hang, which is easy to detect. But one noticeable feature was on average 18 to 45% of data the injected fault with the silent data corruption error, which is not detected by the basic fault, the hardware-based fault detection mechanism. So the output of data was corrupted, but programmer or whoever runs the program didn't recognize that in GPU if there was a fault, just one single bit upset. And this portion is much larger than the data measured in CPU. This has been done a lot during like last 10 years, and most of those work reports less than 2.3% of silent data corruption errors in CPU programs. The reason behind this is GPU doesn't have fine-grained error protection mechanism like the MMU, which enforces the page granularity permission checking, but GPU has a shared memory mechanism. Every core can access entire memory space. There is no protection. Even the address is corrupted. No, this will not be detected. And the massive use of 14-sensitive floating point type of data. GPU uses floating type of data largely, large amount of floating point data, but floating point data in nature is a data, pure data. Even they are corrupted, they are not detected. They are not used for control operation, like the address or division by zero. Floating point division by zero doesn't cause exception. So, you know, that's another reason we could analyze. So the Harvard fault tolerance model uses this program model where the program is split into CPU side code and GPU side code, where the GPU side code processes those computation intensive operation like the loops and run them in parallel using multiple cores that here. And because this sequential code runs on the CPU side and the parallel code runs on the GPU side, isolated physically, for example, connected through PCI and located in the PCI card, 14 here can only propagate to CPU side through the explicit messaging interface between those two. So when you run this parallel code, we explicitly send the code and input data and process it and receive the output. So if we had a crash at here, that will be automatically detected, and this one, the CPU side code can re-execute the same kernel. But if there is a silent error corruption error, the output would be corrupted, but we never know unless we have like Harvard-like technology. So here the design principle is we don't place error detectors where detection is already provided by other existing mechanisms, such as crashes and hangs can be automatically detected. So we don't, you know, we avoid overwrapping between those error detectors. That's our one design principle. So here we focus on silent error corruption error detection. And these are the summary of the existing work. The ideal technology is having 100% coverage with a small overhead. And the simple technique is software implemented full duplication, which is simply re-execute the same GPU kernel twice. So overhead is slightly higher than 100% and coverage is close to 100%. And the other technique is optimizing this full duplication, exploiting instruction data or thread-level parallelisms. But in GPU, the recent work shows 16% of overhead reduction, which is actually quite large as compared with the same technique applied to CPU that showed 41% performance overhead, which is almost double. The reason behind this is GPU program is heavily optimized by the programmer. So if we duplicate the optimized program, the duplicated instance will seek the same type of parallelisms and hardware resources, which is already used by the original program. So the efficiency of using underutilized resources in this technique is pretty low. So that's why this technique we believe is not effective in GPU write those parallel cores. And the other technique people have developed wrong is the selective protection, limiting their protection to a highly error-sensitive state. And those error-sensitive states can be identified by the fault injection, static analysis, or dynamic profiling. But the problem of this technique is as we reduce the overhead, the coverage also goes down. So, you know, if this, you know, continuously goes away from this idea or target. And the last technique we can mention is the algorithm-level technique, which is specifically customized the fault tolerance mechanism to a specific type of algorithm like the matrix multiplication, which was done, I think, around 20 years ago in CSL. And another technique would be optimizing the same technique for the specific type of fault, like the memory transient fault. Those are effective, but if we try to apply in a large scale, If you have like 10 different programs, we need to hire like 10 different experts, and they have to optimize those error detectors. That's a lot of cost. So here we present the Harvard technique, which exactly placed in here, 15% overhead and 85% coverage. But this is only applicable for GPU programs. We can't use it for CPU because this technique is optimized for these type of programs. So the Harvard framework itself is a source-to-source translator that analyzes the source program and derives the Harvard error detectors. And it's the same type of program, right? In case if it is NVIDIA GPU, it's CUDA C++, and we generally emit the CUDA C++ program. And we link them using the Harvard libraries, depending on the purpose of our experiment, and generate the final program binary. Here, one design principle is we optimize these generated error detectors by considering the common characteristic of the target program, like the general purpose GPU programs. One key design decision was having two different error detectors for loop and non-loop portions of program code. That is motivated by this design. We measure the execution time of loops in common those seven GPU programs, the Parboil benchmark developed also by the impact group in CRHC. And on average, about 85% of execution time spent on the loops. Because those GPU cores are parallel core, and initially they were loop, and even we transform them, still there are a large portion of loop out there. So if we place error detectors in the loop, the overhead would be quite significant. So we develop lightweight error detector for loop, and we use a strong but effective technique for the non-loop portion of code. So first technique is the non-loop error detector. Assume this one is, we have a one loop and we have non-loop code before and after the loop. And this is the definition of a variable. This is some computation. And this is a user variable. Assume this simple model. One simple technique to protect errors in this computation or in the register would be duplicating this definition statement and checking after the last use what the dominator of last use is, if we have multiple last uses. And we check whether the original and duplicated value is same. The problem of this naive approach is the increased register pressure. This is the right range of this duplicated variable, which across the loop. So we almost double the register pressure. And while executing this loop, if register overflow occurs, then we need to access the memory, which is quite, which takes pretty long time in GPU as compared with the CPU computation time. So to avoid this overhead, we developed this simple approach, which immediately compares the output data and update the checksum values using the original data and adhere at the after the last use. And because we updated XOR checksum using the same variable twice, checksum should be zero. And the same checksum could be used to protect multiple variables because still this rule holds. And here we only added one register. So we minimized the increase in the register pressure, but still providing similar error detection coverage at here. And the second technique is the loop error detector, which uses the clearly uses the selective protection because the overhead would be very large if we don't use the selective protection inside the loop. Assume 10 instructions inside the loop. If we add four instructions, just four instructions for error detection, overhead would be 40% because loop contribute to the 85% of the entire execution time. So we drew the data flow graph of the loop, and these black boxes are the variables protected by the non-loop error detector, and these are the offsets of this loop. And we clearly select this because the backward data flow dependency of this variable is larger than this one, if we have to protect only one variable. Because errors that here can propagate, and we are more likely to detect errors. This one variable has much wider coverage than this one, so we protect this. So the protection error detection routine is like this, very simple. Energy x2 accumulation to the accumulator. So it's a sum of this variable through the entire loop iteration. We count the number of loop iteration and divide it. And this gives us the average value of this protected variable while executing the loop. So we profile this value range of this average value, and if the measured data violate, is outside scope of those profiled range, we assume there would be an error and start a diagnosis. This is motivated by this measurement data. We profile the value range of integer and floating point value of multiple programs, and this is one from MRIQ program. And here you can clearly see those variables only use very small range of values. Floating point value, even assuming single precision data, the value space is really wide. Example is 22 minus 126 to 22 128. Very wide state. But human, the program written by human are actually using only part of this space. But the fault itself causes a random change in the value. Fault can occur in any bit in the floating point value, and it almost changes the value to any random value. The fault in this value could go to anywhere in this range space. If it goes to here, it clearly largely changes the even averaged value, and we can detect it. So that's the main design idea. And we have extra the recovery method to diagnose the false positive in this scheme. So this is experimental methodology. So this is the result. The optimized full duplication, we implemented the same technique in our framework. And the overhead was about 89%, the one optimized full duplication. And in one case, we couldn't even compile that because that increased the register pressure, the shared memory, used the shared memory space. The optimized full duplication duplicate entire memory space and sometimes cause overflow in shared resources. And in Harvard technique, the average performance overhead was 15.3%. And one case, the RPAS, the overhead was large because this one has large portion of sequential code, which is actually not quite common in GPU. So the recent, the Parboil benchmark, this benchmark, but this program has been removed, but we used the older version, so we measure the data. So the in terms of coverage, the average error detection coverage was 86.8%, and if we assume two independent faults, the coverage is 98.3%. So this simple detector can detect large portion of hardware fault that could read the silent data corruption errors. So going to detail, if we have multi-bit errors, the failure ratio of program like the crashes and hang increase. This is obvious because multi-bit error changes more large value errors. And some detected but masked errors are large in some cases it's not. That actually depends on the output correctness requirement. These PNS and RPAS, output correctness requirement is 1%, 2%, but in this case it was 0.2%, and in that case it was 0%. So that part of the ratio depends on this program characteristic. And undetected error ratio, we couldn't actually logically, we couldn't find the right factor that has direct linear correlation with undetected error. The reason is, assume this simple statement x equal y divided by 0. If we are protecting x using the loop error detector, if fault was injected in y, then the coverage will go up as we have more many bit errors. But if we have a fault in z, the coverage will go down because the value of this expression becomes smaller. So it's not that intuitive. This was actually some counterintuitive example that we find. And this is the false positive ratio of some programs. So we select four representative programs. And in three programs, the false positive ratio goes down quickly after like 7 to 30 training using the 30 different input data sets and run them. And those error detectors are trained. But in some program like MRI FHD, this ratio didn't go down below 10%. So we use this adaptive calibration of the parameter alpha. Alpha is the factor that is multiplied to the value range, profiled value range. is like multiplied to the maximum value of the profiled value range and divided to the minimum value of the profiled value range. So the profiled value range become larger. If we have larger value, then false positive ratio go down, but the coverage also actually goes down. So if the alpha was 100, we find that the false positive ratio quickly goes down even in this MRI FHD program. And we analyze the coverage in the same situation, and the coverage was still same until the alpha was smaller than 1,000. If alpha is larger than 10,000, the coverage was decreased. But until this part, 1,000, it was okay in this MRI FHD program. So we could find that this adaptive calibration method is quite effective and can effectively manage the false positive in real execution scenario. So the conclusion of our work is we have developed the soft-implemented fault injector for commodity GPU device, which is the, as far as we know, is the first fault injector for GPU device publicly announced. And we analyze, we find the silent error, corruption error problem in GPU. We design the application-specific error detection mechanism and the recovery mechanism, and a prototype system is implemented using the CIDR's source-to-source translator. And the evaluation results show the coverage of 15% and the detection coverage of around 85%. Thank you.
Thank our speaker.